We are back with you, and let's continue the discussion we had about the projections that we said were narcissistically. We worship these perceptions. We prostrate in adoration, return gestures in elation, spiraling circles of illusion, a circumference in search of a lost center. The two keywords in this stanza are worshiping narcissistically and a circumference in search of a lost center. The two are basically speaking about the flip side of the same phenomenon. When we talk about narcissism, the idea is the obsession with the self, with the ego, to a point that nothing else matters except that they matter only in relation to the ego. it has to be the height of self-worship, if we can term it as such. So narcissistically, we worship these projections. Now remember, the projections were also those of the self. Then therefore, the silhouette that you're worshiping as the other is none other than the self through a projection. So yeah, we prostrate, and the adoration is supposedly that of another god. But if you're lost with the self, then all you're doing is worshiping yourself, and the God has become irrelevant. Now, the spiraling circles of illusions, that is a reference to that self-centeredness expanding outwards, and the more it expands, the more things it includes as an extension of the self. So it's the self that is permeating and that is kind of filling the space. Now, a circumference in search of a lost center. In Islamic mystic thought, the center of a circle is supposedly invisible. So the simple existence of a circumference by itself is enough to be seen as the circle of existence. Now, that scientifically speaking, or in the context of a geometric theory, there is no denial of the center. A circle has to have a center. But the center doesn't have to be visible. In fact, the more invisible, the more accurate, because it theoretically has to be dimensionless. And if you think about it logically, if it is dimensionless, then it's invisible. So what is the circle? What is the center? The center of the circle is the divine, which is there. It is undeniable, because God is there, invisible, undeniable. And in the same way that a circumference cannot be circumference, cannot be going around, unless there is at least a hypothetical center around which the circumference bends and forms the whole circle. So if we are thinking of God as the center of this, the invisible center of this circle, then the circumference becomes the manifestation of God, the creations of God. So in a way, in a similar way, in a way that the circumference defines the circle, even if the center is invisible, the manifestations of God, in a way, defines God, even if God is invisible. And therefore, the truth is not necessarily in the visibility of a phenomenon, but the circumference and the circumstance, which by virtue of its own necessity imply that there is no denying of the center. And in the last two lines of this stanza, when it says a circumference in search of a lost center, it's a reference to the human soul searching and trying to return to the divine. And the center is not necessarily lost, but it's lost to the perception, to the limitations of the human perception. For too long shadows have claimed us in their own distorted darkness, tracing self in its own paces from now here to nowhere to nowhere. There is a play on words, and let me start with that. Now here is the cross point, the center of the two dimensions, or the dimensionalities of time and space. Now is the time, and here is the place. And if you take the same letters, now and here, and now move the W to the second word, you're not changing any letters except changing their places. So now here becomes no, and the W will join here, it becomes where. So now here becomes nowhere, which simply means that this reality defined within the context of the time and space dimensions of the now in reality don't exist. And then it goes to the next step, which is now phonetically similar to nowhere. No is K-N-O-W, same pronunciation. Where is the placeness? So it becomes knowledge. So therefore, from now here to know where, to know where. So the idea is that you are at the end asking that question, is that you want to know, if you are not the center of the universe, then where is it? And that is what you're searching. So, for too long, shadows have claimed us. This would be the shadow side of our personalities, of our ego-centered personalities. That it is the shadow we identify with rather than the selfless self that we ought to. In their own distorted darkness. Yes, the darkness doesn't simply imply our inability to see, but in the inability of not being able to see, we have distorted things as a way to claim ourselves as the center instead of the divine. In other words, this gravitational flow, or we could say the gravitational pull, is such that a God-centered universe in which the human plays a peripheral role has in essence become a human-centered universe, with God being consistently and persistently pushed out of the equation and has reached a point of irrelevance. Because we humans, at least in our time, the perception of God is such that from a time in the past of several centuries and millennia, when God was the absolute necessary entity because we could not control our environment. So gods of fire, of floods, of raging flames, of all the things that happen in nature, became in essence a manifestation of God. In other words, the wrath of nature equaled God. So in modernity, when we humans have been able to, or at least we pretend that we are able to, control our nature, our environment, that we have become in charge, therefore, just as the threat of nature has been either eliminated or limited, the relevance of God has equally been made to disappear. And so therefore, the gods of the environment became subject to the human and the human-centered activity. So that's where it's the thought that for too long, shadows have claimed us in their own distorted darkness. That because God was equated to an entity other than what it ought to have been, therefore that God could not afford to have a permanent existence. Because as we humans claim to have conquered nature, in essence, we conquered God, and then we are in charge. The virtue to be different, of indifference to be one with every being. We made reference to the human nature as to how we try to make things similar that are created differently. And we go back and forth. And the nature of nature being such that it's in the diversity that the canvas is painted with the beauty of nature. Whereas our human nature, that is an ego-centered nature, then applies a different criteria. That we want to make the differences similar, that instead of appreciating it, instead of understanding their complementarity, we reverse the natural activity. And then it's the indifference to that, to the nature, that we want to define our souls. Leave the solace of seclusion. Fly away to the far distance blue horizons. Beneath freshly painted clouds on the edge of great divide. To awareness in wholeness where matter doesn't matter. And mind surely doesn't mind. In divine domain, a splendor in celestial beauty's glances, remain still to be reflected in all beings once again. This is the concluding stanza, where all the paradoxical opposition between the human and the divine phenomena that has been going in the opposite directions, each lost in its own way. God lost in human perception, and humanity lost in the absence of a more appropriate understanding of God. In the loss of God being solely a medium to accommodate our existence and not acknowledging the totality of the cosmic reality, the harmony, the cosmic, the convergence, harmonic convergence in the totality of that cosmic reality. That's where the poem now goes to sort of reconcile and draw a conclusion and help us understand it in a different way in case our perspective was too different from that which was described in the earlier stanzas. So the poem says, leave the solace of seclusion. Seclusion has its own beauty. It allows you to go within, to contemplate, to think, to understand. Great thinkers have often come up, have often understood the cosmic reality better in seclusion, not in the midst of a huge throng of people. Buddha had to leave the palace to go to the jungle for seclusion. Moses had to go to Mount Sinai for seclusion. Jesus had to leave Palestine and disappear, probably somewhere in India, to get lost in order to find himself. And Prophet Muhammad did exactly the same thing. He had to leave the environs of Mecca, where he saw so much darkness, so much lowliness and loneliness, at the cultural level, at the civil level, social justice or injustice, economic injustice, and so forth. He took refuge from all these miseries of the humanity in the environment with which he was familiar. And he had to go to a dark cave, a seclusion that gave him solace. But once he got the message, that's where his physical being in a cave 2 miles away from Mecca wasn't going to constrain him, to limit him. Now he had the ability to fly. And today that Muhammad is in the heart of every believing Muslim, thousands of miles away from that dark cave in Mecca, is in essence the thought that came to him. Fly away to the far distant blue horizons, beneath freshly painted clouds, on the edge of great divide, to awareness in wholeness. Now, this distant blue horizon may be perceived as the geographic horizon, but in reality, it's more than that. It's beneath the freshly painted clouds, which means there are veils beyond the visible reality that we have, and going beyond that. Where? To the edge of great divide. That divide is reference to the visible reality versus the invisible. And the invisible could be measured either by the human senses, that beyond a certain point we have no ability to see, but it could be other layers of reality. And that is called to awareness in wholeness. When you sense the wholeness of the totality of existence, the cosmic reality. And where is that reality? Not simply in scientific terms that 95-96% of nature, we are talking about the cosmic reality out there, is not matter, but dark energy and black holes. In other words, the material, the material portion of the entire cosmos amounts to no more than 4 or 5%. So is the rest of it, the 95-96%, a void, a nothingness, or there is something more there? And that's what this poem is addressing, where matter doesn't matter. Yes, it's a play on words, but it's a serious one. Where matter doesn't matter. What matters is more than matter. And mind surely doesn't mind. Another play of words, but again, with the same serious tone of voice, where mind surely doesn't mind. In other words, this mind would be either a perception, or whether you allow that perception to create a reality within you. And in there, in divine domain splendor, in celestial beauty's glances, remain still to be reflected in all beings once again. It's in that environment where, of course, to speak the Quranic parlance, there is a realm to which you have to reach if you assume a physicality understandable to the human mind. The ascension of the Prophet is a testimonial to that. That is the divine presence. That's the divine domain, where the celestial beauties glances, and therefore the glances would, we have a beautiful word for it in Arabic, which is called lamahat, which is a glance that happens once, and the rarity of that in itself is valued in a relationship where every moment measures the quality of that which is being seen. And in the Sufi language, we talk about shahid and mashhud, that the divine beloved becomes your romantic other, to which you relate in the most beautiful language there is, which in essence makes Islamic mysticism much more of a romantic and much more of an immanent relationship between the human and the divine. It is beyond the concept of worshipping, because worship is then perceived to be a matter of necessity. The worshipper worships that which is being worshipped. Therefore, each defines the other out of the necessity of the roles they play. But love is a stronger power. That is not a matter of necessity. Because when you are in need, you are not complete. You're missing something. The divine is not incomplete. So if the divine is the totality, there is no missing piece in there. And therefore, God comes to you as the lover, you the beloved, and you return the favor through a role reversal. You become the lover, not the mere worshiper of God, but the lover of God. For it, he, she, is the divine beloved. And in that, the poem is asking you to remain still. The stillness is critical, because in stillness there are no words to disturb the unspoken thought, the unspoken emotion. Quite often we humans fall prey to our own nonsensical utterances. Silence has its own beauty. Stillness has its own beauty. Remain still to be reflected in all beings once again. Thank you.